Okay, so we'll call the question.
Didn't I ask for a question for the agenda?
I have no comments on here, no changes to the agenda.
Anybody else?
No.
From the public?
Changes in the agenda?
They don't have any say about the agenda. Public question.
Question?
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Unanimous. Let's bring up the consent calendar, draft minutes of regular meeting. Motion to approve.
So moved.
Second.
Yes, excuse me, what, was that the consent calendar?
Yeah.
Yeah, we're on the...
That's it, okay.
We're on the draft minutes.
Now's the...
Paid bills.
Right.
Any questions? The only question I have is, do we miss a pay period in December?
Oh, no, it just didn't get added to that one. We didn't miss it, I just got the flu.
Oh.
Sorry.
But I will tell you that I wish that pay period was included because I do know that it had a lot less overtime.
Oh, that's a good thing.
I was looking for it in here too because I know one's pretty high.
Well, no, the first one was lower.
You'll see the second December payment in with the January claim.
All right.
Sorry.
What was your turn? You got what?
The flu.
The flu, oh.
I was not physically here.
I see.
I have no questions on either the agenda or on the bills paid.
Neither do I.
All right, how about from the public?
Yeah, well, you didn't mention the minutes, and that's what I wanted to comment on. You know, once again, we're not getting accurate minutes. I am keeping records of everything. And I just think that there needs to be greater care taken in reflecting actual language, not interpreted actions. You know, specifically the items that mentioned me, I'm not gonna go through them one by one, but they're not accurate. And if you're gonna put minutes this way together, which is not recommended, you've got to be accurate. So, you know, issues are raised here in this body because you do not, there is a lack of accuracy in following established government procedures, and there's been this shutting down of speech, and that, you know, that is potentially an issue. I know there's other issues you're looking at, but that's potentially an issue you may have to deal with in the future if you continually ignore your responsibilities to the public.
Anything else?
That's all I have to say.
Thank you. Call for a vote.
On favor, aye.
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 Aye. All those in favor.
Was that too long?
Jeff's leading the witness.
Yes.
Let's go to F, public comment, open time for not on the agenda. Stephen.
Okay, so in keeping with the speech and government transparency and honesty and the whole bit, I don't see it here. I did see something in the packet, but as you all are aware, I have made three requests for information regarding the solar project. I note that Eric has come back to me, and I guess he's talked with you guys, but he said he doesn't have any information to give me. Well, he put something in the calendar, in the packet, that says, yes, there's information coming back and forth. So it really does appear that there's an effort to stonewall information. You know, this is a big deal because you guys made a huge effort to do this solar project. You were warned by the public that there was some questionable things in that contract that could cost the district money. And now, when there are problems, you don't want to talk about it. Well, you're the government. There's laws that are being broken right now. And if the project is not on track, we're paying a guy a lot of money to keep it on track. We're paying a lot of money to the solar company. Who is holding these people responsible? This is your responsibility. You guys are representing the taxpayers, okay? You're not representing contractors. That's all I have to say.
Thank you, Stephen. I'll let that go. Anybody else? Okay, district matters. Update from the ad hoc committee. Mr. Jeff Naylor, regarding the liabilities, future unfunded.
Right. So this will hopefully be the last report on this unfunded liability from the ad hoc committee that was formed back in February of last year in order to study this. It just happens to coincide with CalPERS announcement in the last, I think it was the first day of winter, actually. That they are going to gradually, over a period of 3 years, decrease their discount rate. Our district was among a myriad of districts that wrote back feedback indicating our desire to not have them drop it from 7.5 to 7 all at once in a single year. That would be catastrophic for particularly districts our size. At any rate, from 2018-19, the rate will drop to 7.375, 2019-20 to 7.25, and finally, 2020-21, it will drop to 7. Okay. What this does is it increases the percentage of normal costs. This is the percentage that the district will pay for each employee under a pension plan, each payroll. By various percentages, and it will also increase what is known as the ARC, annually required contribution. And in the packet, I've got a couple of charts that basically point out what will happen using the 2016-17 payroll as an example. It will not affect us next year, it'll affect us the following year, but it gives you an indication of what the impact might be. Long story short, between the normal rate and the ARC, there's every possibility that we will go from approximately $280,000 hard dollars that are going out to pay for the pensions in a year to $623,000. Okay? This is a real expense that goes out. It's legally required, and it puts in specific relief how volatile these pension amounts are and what it could do to our district. So, again, I invite you to look at the report that's in the packet. It points, directly to a particular pension plan that is the pension plan that's causing most of the expense and will continue to do so. Okay. Nevertheless, we do have some time to do this. Staff here has done a tremendous job of work, or a tremendous amount of work, to understand what capital equipment they're going to need to replace over the next 10 years, and put together a spreadsheet so that we can anticipate what we will need to set aside for capital replenishment. New equipment, et cetera, without having to borrow for that. So the committee is recommending that we journal $100,000 from our income statement to our balance sheet. That does not mean we're setting it aside in a fund that we can't touch.
It's essentially just removing it from the income statement and putting it in a balance sheet account where those funds will be available as needed for capital acquisitions. Finally, the OPEB trust fund. We voted to create a trust fund at last month's meeting. We have yet to decide whether to commit any funds to the trust fund. We're going to be looking very carefully at both the stock market and post inauguration changes that might come to gauge what's going to happen in the market before doing anything. And also, we certainly need another review of our financial situation before we decide to commit any funds to that particular account. The term irrevocable is used for this trust fund. It means that once we put money into that account, it can be used for only one purpose, and that is retiree health care. It does not mean that we can't take funds out of it to pay for current retiree health care costs. Okay, so we can get the money back that we put in. We can also get the money back that we've earned interest on if we need it in a cash flow crisis. Okay, but again, we have incurred no costs. We will not incur costs until we actually put something into the account. And when we do, it'll be 10 basis points. If I remember correctly, that was $100 on a $100,000 deposit. Okay? So that's what I can tell you about that. Again, we'll be looking at that. We'll be looking at it in public with you in attendance, and we will be seeking your input as well. And that's the report.
Awesome. Do we have any questions?
I think it's, I'd like to thank you for all the work you've done. It's tremendous. I don't know how many hours you spent on this, but probably way too many.
3 or 4.
But I think it's beautiful for everybody involved with district business to finally see numbers and have hard data and just to know where we stand and how significant the problem is. Also, just a couple of interesting notes. 80% of the district's total pension annual required contribution for 8 safety employees.
That's correct. Actually, let me qualify that. It's 75% right now. By the time we get to the end of that term, 82.3.
Yeah.
But yeah, I mean, it's a significant chunk.
Right. No, again, thank you for an amazing, tremendous amount of work you've done.
Sure.
I think it's our obligation to act upon it and proceed with the recommendation.
It gives us hard numbers for the coming budgets, too, for mm-hmm. these fiscal periods. Really hard numbers.
Hard to look at numbers.
So we reviewed that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
No.
Anything from the public? Stephen.
Sure. First of all, thanks. I would also say thanks for your hard effort. I think the thrust or the idea of this proposal is a good one. It shows forward thinking. And as you know, there's a but. And the but is, number one, when you say irrevocable trust, I'm going to say this every time you bring it up and say we can get the money out. We can get the money out just like you can get the money out of an IRA with a penalty, of foregone interest. So it's really not a cost-free. It's a one-way trip with our money. It's not, and it is for pension costs or OPEB or whatever you want to call it. It's for our retirees. That's item number one. Item number two is we all got a wake-up call, and I know you guys can't talk about it, with our Christmas gift from our employee union concerning overtime due on some of the benefits that we offer them. I don't know how that's going to shake out. I don't know what was written into the contract. If it was written into the contract that way, I would suggest don't even bother with fighting it. Just pay them. but then reassess how we go forward. And one of the problems I have with this whole package here, the assumption is that we're never going to make any changes to our fire department, and I think that is a fallacy. We've got to make changes because we're not going to be able to afford all these expenses in a small district without serious tax increases. And right now, it's been this way ever since we entered into this agreement. Half of our fire department calls are outside our area, and we don't send our employees out, our park employees out, or department employees out to do work for other districts. I think we're way off base with the way that we have our fire services structured. The guys here probably wouldn't be interested in me saying that, but I really think that one of the reasons why this trust fund is a bad idea is we're losing negotiation leverage should we want to change the way our fire department is set up. What's that? Well, you promised money to perhaps, you've obligated funds, taxpayer funds, long term, and you've lost the flexibility in the short term to make changes. And I do agree that you should be setting aside money, but it shouldn't be irrevocable, it should be flexible, and quite frankly, it should be something that you use at the negotiation table.
As far as the OPEB trust is concerned, over the last, how many years, decades, money, we've been on a pay-as-you-go schedule for OPEB, okay? That means that the liability for these future healthcare benefits for our employees continue to grow well beyond the point where we're ever going to be able to afford them, okay? I would just rather to put something in an account that actually earns interest, that we can earn for the benefit of our employees. We're not just talking about fire department here. We're talking about all of the employees in the district, okay? And I think that, you know, frankly, I appreciate what you're saying. I think we will deal with this account prudently. We will not over, you know, commit to funds. I believe that this district, I hear your words about the fire department and how the fire department is structured. I appreciate that, okay? And we will consider that. But also, we need to, as you pointed out several times in past meetings, we need to consider capital reserves, capital assets, not borrowing, using our funds more judiciously. And that's one of the things that this analysis has pointed out to us and that we're pursuing. So again, we will look at this we'll look at this over time. We'll make decisions based on what we see coming in as revenue. If there are new revenue sources, terrific, that gives us some latitude. But I would much rather than have certain funds languish in a general account earning no interest whatsoever, have them in a fund where they actually earn interest. And that's what's provoked this analysis.
Thank you. Respond back to some of your points?
Feel free.
Okay, first of all, I'm a little bit more pessimistic than you, but I see the rate of growth of liabilities easily outstripping our ability to pay, which means bankruptcy could be an option. I don't want it to be an option. I think what you're suggesting is a very smart thing to do, set aside the money. You're presenting a false choice when you say not earning any interest. You certainly could create a pool of money, but have it in a an account that you can withdraw from. I just think you're missing the ball here, because in the event of a bankruptcy, if it's in an irrevocable trust, that money can't be touched, period. And while I do feel morally committed to such a position, I think in practical terms, you know, we're gonna need to make some big changes, difficult choices. So
thank you, I understand.
Okay.
All right. So we have a motion to approve dissolution of the IHOP.
So moved. Second.
Any questions?
Luke?
Thanks. Good point. I know it's a lot of time and energy.
Yeah. Ad hoc means, you know, time constraint. We had a year, and the year was because during the process of looking at unfunded liabilities, we said, oh, maybe we should consider capital reserves too. That took a little bit extra time, but we've done that, and we've really finished our analysis. I think we've educated the board to a certain extent so that, you know, we can together make some good decisions going forward.
Yep. We've got some hard numbers, you know.
Harder
to look at. See, how about a vote to approve?
Aye.
Thank you.
So, next is the district manager report.
Rick, not too much on here this month. We have done all of our field work for the audit, so that's done. I actually just received a draft copy of the report, the management report, literally last night, so I haven't had a chance to go through it yet. I will. I'll provide whatever feedback will be in the present on February for official acceptance. Property tax revenue first half has come in for the most part. I just kind of included the general numbers down there, 910 and change in general ad valorem property taxes, and then 766, 356 in special tax assessments. And then with the solar project, as I've kind of stated multiple times in this platform, we've been waiting on PG&E now for quite some time. They have gave us an original notice that was dated the 19th of December that they had a set date to come fix it. I don't know if any of you remember that date.
January 3rd.
Had big time weather issues, so that was postponed. Right now it is tentatively rescheduled for January 19th, I believe. Yep. So they should come out. I anticipate it'll be able to get fixed up and hooked up and interconnected shortly thereafter. My other understanding that I put in this is some of the issue for the delay, because they actually called me originally to tell me about it. The third was canceled on the third. Was that they did need to obtain a permit from the county for the work, mostly because it was a planned outage, not they just blew a transformer. Secondarily, it's shutting off power to this building and to a fire department, so they have to jump a couple extra hoops for that.
Is it going to be the local area as well?
I don't know, to be quite honest with you. If you did not receive a notice, then I would say you are not affected.
Okay. I don't want to have to go into San Francisco.
Right, yeah, these both came via mail, and I think they would have sent them to anybody who is
Power sense.
That day.
Yeah, okay.
Out of curiosity, the county fees and the ad valorem taxes?
Yes.
What kind of an increase from the previous period?
From last year?
Yeah.
I'd have to look to give you a good answer. I mean, it's pretty much around, I don't think there was much of an increase. It's kind of set by a legislation of they can take X amount.
Right.
That's be something.
But the ad valorem, wasn't there an increase for the fire?
Are you talking about the fees or the actual fees. Amount collected?
The collect.
No, the ad valorem tax, I think. That's what you mean.
The
ad valorem is probably higher than last year because of the property value.
Sure. Yeah. And I haven't had a chance, Bill, to be honest with you, to look at them.
Okay.
side by side yet, and then say, okay, this equals approximately 55%, what can we now expect? This was more notice that these funds are in our fund at this point in time.
And then after PG&E on the 19th, they're finished, they wrap things up, we'll be on the line?
Then they have to interconnect it, but yeah.
They have to interconnect it?
No. The system itself, yes.
Okay.
But again, my understanding is that everything is in place at this point in time. They just need that to go and basically connect a couple wires, put a switch in the way.
So PG&E does not have to be there for the actual hookup?
I don't know. But PG&E has already done their inspection of the entire process, yeah.
Okay. I have a question. How long were you on our dry period line this year?
Well, approximately a month and a half.
A month and a half.
Yeah, it was right about the end of October, and they started taxes, everything started coming in around December 15th.
Would you say, based on your knowledge of past history, that wasn't, you know, tremendously longer than usually?
I would say it might even have been shorter than last year. It was about the same amount of time.
Okay. The reason I ask is because at the beginning of the year, we voted to pay the ARC up front.
That was a good decision.
Saving ourselves, I think, almost $9,000. And I think the concern was, oh boy, we're going to go into dry period in August or something, but that was not the case.
Yeah, no, it was close to Halloween that time when it
happened. Very good. Thank you.
Any other questions from the public?
No, I have no questions.
We got the fire department matters, the activity summary, and chief report.
Any questions? Yeah, you guys met the two new firefighter paramedics for in the new hire academy. That's kind of exciting. It'll be done mid-February. It'll be online the week after that. So you'll actually have three paramedics in the department, one on each shift. Captain's testing process was done. You noticed Brandon and Ryan were both promoted.
So I just wanted to state for the record, I'm sorry for interrupting. The only thing that's preventing the community from receiving paramedic service is the union holding it up.
Correct. I lost my train of thought on that one, but
you were talking about the captain.
Yeah, so the new captain's online. I have a captain's meeting next week with those two and John Papanicolaou, just to kind of go over 2017 and some of the goals I'm looking for from the department for each shift. And then there's some information I put in here on the fire inspection process that will be included in the captain's meeting, their assignments for the yearly inspections and how that paperwork is kept and maintained, just to make sure we don't end up in a similar situation that Oakland experienced with there.
And I notice you shift those around each year.
I move them around each year just because it's good for when they do the inspection. I mean, there's a lot of different things that go on. You get to eyeball the building and notice where the fire department connections are and everything. They're back. Brandon, I just want to introduce Brandon, who is one of the new fire captains in the department. Ryan was going to come down, but he was having some weather-related issues with himself, so he couldn't go to the trip. So I'm excited to be working with them moving forward.
Very good. Congratulations.
Thank you. Good.
Did you mention engineer tests?
I did not, but an engineer's exam will be happening. I'll probably get the announcement out towards the end of this month. I anticipate we'll have two people who are certified and qualified to take that exam for one current position.
Thank you.
And the fire commission will meet next week, and the fire department budget is on our list of priorities. This information you gave about unfunded liabilities would be very helpful. Informative.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. The property up the way on Lucas Valley Road, you know, if you can get past all the fallen trees, is there anything going on with that? I know you had.
Are we talking about
the four houses?
Headfields?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Nothing currently. I don't think they've submitted a plan. Eric and I have had some meetings with them. I've given them some preliminary information on what the fire department requires, but I don't think they've submitted yet. I did get some information back from the Oaks. They are submitting a plan, mm-hmm. and they're looking for feedback from the district. I'm going to get them some of that tomorrow. I think they're going to move forward pretty quickly. It wouldn't surprise me if we saw a plan finalized towards the middle of the year to allow a developer to get to work on that property.
Do you expect them to come back and talk to us directly, like they did the last time?
The Oaks?
Mm-hmm.
No.
Okay.
I don't. I'm current, but the plan that I have before me, we're allowed to give them feedback and information related on the services that we provide that area, which is basically fire, park, and rec. So I'll give them a lot of code requirements, roadway width, building construction, hydrant location, sprinkler location, and all the information I give them over the next day or two. And I've given it all to the architect previously, so I have it all ready. And then again, with the storms the last few days, we've been pretty lucky in Marinwood. We've weathered the storm, so to speak, pretty well. There hasn't been any major flooding. I think Shane and his guys did a lot of preventative work leading up to it, which is extremely helpful. Keep the water moving, and we don't see any problems. So when backups start, that's when we run into issues pretty quickly. Had some tree down, some trees down, some minor flooding, but no real major property damage or injuries. So, yeah, it should be this, and the storm should be letting up right as we speak. So, we're looking for some dry weather the next couple of days.
Back to the Oaks, do you have any say whatsoever over the plan to put street lights at certain corner intersections?
No.
Okay.
I don't.
I mean, is that an impediment to speedy fire service in our district?
No.
It is not?
No.
Okay. All right, fair enough. I'd like to say thanks to the fire department, because those of us who read next door realize that you were out there helping with all these downed trees and this and that. It's good to see our department, being first responders in that regard as well.
Yeah, they were great, actually. I was gone. I was in Spokane for the early parts of the storm over the weekend, and I showed up, got back here Sunday around lunchtime and came in, and there was 10 guys in the firehouse staffing all three apparatus, running the emergency calls and out doing preventative checks, just like I had hoped. So, thank you for that.
It was a good response all the way around, because yeah. I even made a call to somebody, and it turned out okay.
All right.
And the, any other questions?
Yeah, you're talking about Oaks, the senior project.
Correct.
Next, okay, great. I'm glad that that's moving ahead.
Yeah.
That's excellent.
Date of the next fire commission meeting is February 7th.
Correct.
On to park and rec. Recreation and park maintenance activity report.
So we can start with the recreation report. Just real quick, we have a couple events coming up. We have a homebrew happy hour scheduled for Friday, February 10th. Which will be a new event as far as having a homebrew, local homebrew people, so that should be good. Isabella's husband, I think, is happy about that. Brandon, who's helping with the event. And then we have Raise a Glass, which is one of our larger events scheduled for February 25th from 2 to 5 here, where we have about a dozen wineries and music, and it's a really good community gathering. We just finished winter camp the past 2 weeks. We had a really good winter camp season, 161 campers. Our profit was up quite a bit because we were able to accommodate some more kids this time around because we have the staff available.
Was it 5 days?
It was 4 and 4, I believe, yeah.
That's beautiful money for the
number of
days.
Yeah, the staff probably did a great job. There's a lot of illnesses going around, so she did a great job keeping us well staffed still. The review is wrapping up. We have a couple more things we're adding to it, and then it'll go to the printer and be shipped out to the public in mid-February, which is normally when we do it. We need approval on summer camp and pool rates. If you want to start with camp, and I've attached comparisons from other agencies. With camp, we had a great season last year, so we're looking at a 3% increase, which will basically cover the increases in staffing and supplies that we're expecting for 2017, while still keeping our rates competitive. So if you have any questions on camp rates specifically?
Are there going to be changes in rates, in wage rates, or more help?
So the minimum wage continues to rise.
It does.
So that every year for the next 4 or 5 years, it goes up 50 cents, I believe, every year.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, until we get to 15. So we're just gonna see that with pulling camp every year. The kind of bottom rung first year staff, we're gonna see increases there.
Okay. So
the 3% basically keeps us from having to absorb it on our end.
Okay, so you've gone out and you've looked at other agencies that provide these services, and you're not pricing yourself out of the market?
No, we feel like we're right where we need to be.
Okay.
So do we need a vote on the?
Yeah, we need an approval on the camp rates.
I'd like to approve the camp rates for 2017 as presented.
Second that.
Any questions from the public?
Well, I wonder, what is the percentage of customers coming back, or what percentage of new customers do you need every year to make sure that the, your enrollment stays the same?
Well, so enrollment's gone up every single year for the past 10 years. We don't necessarily monitor or look at, how many we lose versus how many we gain, but we know the difference is we get more every year than we lose for the past decade or so.
Okay. Well, do you change your marketing outreach at all?
We bring back our marketing quite a bit. It's mostly word of mouth. We have a line out the door as soon as registration opens up to the point where we're filled to capacity in most of the most popular camps within the first couple of weeks, some in the first couple of days. So
speaks well of you.
Yeah, thanks.
Call for a vote.
All
in favor?
Aye.
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 Yes. Good to you. Thank you. So the next part in rec meeting is pool rates.
So moving on to pool, which is just a little more to do. Pool rates, we're recommending for memberships, no increase this year. Our memberships were slightly up over last year. Terra Linda is not raising their rates this year. We feel keeping them where they're at keeps us competitive, and we kind of hold the line, if not increase the number of memberships slightly. We do have, as of last year, we had a new kind of promotion where if you're not a resident and you want to sign up during the residential period, which is 2 weeks before everyone else, you can sign up for a full membership. So that kind of helped us with the full members, and we'll continue to do so. So it's kind of a, we look at it as a win-win. So in any case, yeah, we're looking at not increasing the memberships this year. We are looking at increasing the punch pass pricing for non-residents, moving it from $30 to $35, and keeping the resident at $25.
How many passes for $35?
Five uses.
Anytime?
Yeah.
Including the last one?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, thank you.
Question?
Oh, and yeah, and then I met with Isabella earlier as far as drop-in rates, and I met with Luke afterwards, and we would actually recommend lowering the Wormwood child rate from $6 to $5 and increasing the non-resident adult rate from $8 to $9, which would put us in line with Terra Linda's rates. And it's kind of going back to where we had the rates a few years ago. Overall, the idea is that our punch passes will increase revenue there. We're also, some areas that you don't see on here that we don't get approval through you would be swim lessons and group picnic rates, pool rates, pool rental rates. We're raising all those as well. So we should cover, again, any additional staffing costs plus a little.
We have to run on that also.
Mm-hmm. Just the rates for the drop-in. The rates you see here, so drop-in, membership, and punch passes.
So, four rates. Can I make a motion?
You may make a motion.
Thank you. To approve the pool rates as amended, with the drop-in rate for the resident child $5, adult staying at $7, drop-in non-resident child $7, and adult changing to $9 as requested by Shane.
I'll second that.
Any questions?
No.
Public?
No.
Call for a vote. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Very good. Now I'm going to assume that we have a meeting for the Park and Rec on January 24th.
We have activities too. Can I ask a question about the truck?
Mm-hmm.
Any updates?
No. No updates.
Okay, so we're looking at what now, 45 days or so?
Yeah, we're looking at the end of February still.
Okay. All right, fair enough. Curiosity question. You know, not to throw the chief under the bus here, but you know, we buy something brand new and there's warranty work that has to be done. Where would that warranty work happen?
From the dealer.
So. From the dealer?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, and the dealer is where?
Ceremony. But with
Ceremony in San Bruno or whatever it is?
But I believe we could take it to any Ford dealership for the 3 year, 36,000. Yeah, I think mm-hmm. we could take it to any dealership.
Mm-hmm. Okay, fair enough. Thank you.
I don't feel thrown under the bus, just so you know.
just under truck, fire engine.
Yeah, just thrown under the fire engine.
We need 58.
Exactly.
Right.
So real quickly in the park maintenance activities, it's everything you see there. The guys have also been working diligently and hard through these past few storms, clearing trees on the creek. We've had some minor damage. The park shop fence fell down. They were able to shore it up for now.
After we tried to push it into the creek.
Yeah. So they've been clearing drains, culverts. We also went up to the Pawnee Fire Road today to inspect it after the county parks reported that there was some cracking, not where the work was done, but a few hundred yards north of that. And there is some water issues and there is some movement. I did bring Tom Horn was available, who's better versed in the geological issues up there. Mm-hmm. And he was kind enough to come up there in the rain. I think he enjoyed it. So in any case, we were able to, between us and the park staff, we're able to divert the water for now, just a temporary fix. We need to go back up there and do some more work. If his opinion was if it did slide right there, it would slide 10 feet, that would be the extent of it. It wasn't any, like if there's any large geological issues like we had at the Pawnee Fire Road. Mm-hmm. There's houses, you know, a few hundred yards below. But we're gonna continue to monitor it. We're gonna go up there as soon as the weather clears and kind of get a better assessment of any issues. We have insurance though now, so.
Yeah, we do. When do we notify the people that are downhill of this thing?
They'll notify us. What I'm guessing.
Well, it sounds like we're going to keep an eye on it anyway.
Yeah, we'll definitely be checking it out.
Yeah, I think it's important to note. I mean, it was ugly out today. Shane, Luke, Victor, and Esteban, I mean, they literally got on their rain gear, drove around to Nevada to the Pacheco entrance, hiked up this trail quite a ways to discover this other area that the county had said, hey, you might want to check this one part of the thing. Just get it in the middle of an ugly part of the day. So,
Appreciate that. Kudos to that.
Absolutely.
You bet. I didn't like walking from my car in the parking lot over here, so I can't imagine. I have a question. How's our ozone machine doing?
Oh, don't ask me.
Come on.
I have a conversation with Luke every few weeks, and I always bring up your name when it comes to ozone and where we're at, because he's kind of the point person. But we 2 days ago, we sent out a long list to the installer and asked him what the deal was. We haven't heard back yet. The county sent us a notice last week, and he received the same notice that some of the requirements they were asking for before, which I guess were above and beyond, they're no longer requiring some of those. So it may make it easier for that to happen. It's still not installed. And we got a notice about our drains needing to be replaced after the forget what the law was passed, it was about 5 years ago, we had to put in the drains, the low flow drains. And all those need to be replaced as well. So we're gonna have to be using the same contractor to replace those because we don't wanna drain the pool, we just got the breathing apparatus, et cetera. So all that work's gonna be happening soon. So when he comes in a few weeks, I'll have a personal conversation with him and see, you know, it's either gonna happen or not, we're gonna be lucky, yeah.
Yeah, understood. Your efforts in the open space, did anybody take a check, take a look out at the, our little project next to the shed and the pool and how that's doing?
Yeah.
You doing okay?
It's good.
Good.
Yeah.
Very good.
Any other problems with fallen trees?
We had on Miller Creek at 584 Miller Creek, a large tree came down and took out their fence, their backyard fence, as well as three of their trees in their backyard. So we're helping.
Where exactly is this?
584 Miller Creek, a couple houses up from the Cases.
The deep trees back there.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And yeah, the homeowner went out there to the other tree that's still standing, and that ground is muddy.
Yeah, we're waiting. I was over there and spent about a half an hour with her yesterday with the homeowner. And they had tree masters come out and look at it, and I'm waiting to hear the results of that tree that's still standing. So, because if that's the case, then that may be an issue for what we would have to.
Yeah, I was going to say, are we expecting the plant?
They filed. I've already been in touch with insurance.
Thanks.
Yep.
Fun stuff.
But never stop.
Any other questions?
No.
From the public?
First of all, with regards to the truck, I guess this is positing this to everybody. We've got a new truck. I put it's about $30,000. Spending some money for a carport, you know, they're made out of aluminum, I think, usually. Something to keep the weather and the crap from falling off of it. I think it would be a great investment. It's not going to look great, but it may actually inspire, the neighbors won't be able to say no to it, and it may inspire them to want something better looking. Yes. So but for the investment's sake, I think it makes a lot of sense. That's item number one. Item number two, and this is an ongoing frustration for me because I walk in the park on a daily basis, and I don't know who's doing the driving back there, but they are driving all over. It seems like they don't like driving on the road, and so we've got deep tracks all over the flora out there, and I don't know. I mean, if you can't get these guys to just simply take care of that area, I think, you know, something's got to happen. That's what we pay you guys for, to take care of that area, to take care of the park over here. And I don't see it, any changes. In fact, I see it's getting a little bit worse. So please respect the park.
Are you specifically talking about the panhandle again?
I'm talking about the panhandle.
Okay. Again,
where it's 30 feet wide, and you can walk back there, you'll see, and especially on rainy days like today, where they don't like getting the tires wet or whatever, but they can put deep ruts all over the place over there. So we should really treat it like the resource that it is.
Okay.
Anybody else?
Okay.
New and other business.
When's the next park and rec meeting?
January 24th,
thank you.
On the 4th, do that.
supposed to appoint board liaisons to the Fire Commission, Park and Recreation Commission, and LAFCO representative.
Those are traditional, the bylaws, it basically states a board liaison to the Fire Commission as well as the Park and Rec Commission. And traditionally, we've had somebody kind of serving as a LAFCO representative. That hasn't really been filled since Justin left. I actually have a pretty good relationship with Keen Simons, their executive director. But still, it never hurts to have a board person who might be willing to reach out to LAFCO when needed, as needed.
Okay. In the past, what has the LAFCO board representative actually done?
Well, Justin attended a LAFCO meeting with me.
He did?
Yeah, we met up with Keen one day to discuss some other things as well. Not much to my knowledge.
Okay, just keep him in touch with
him. I would say right now, if they ever get this municipal service review really kind of up and going, to the point that you made earlier when we talked, they came in and presented about a year ago and kept kind of getting delayed on that, then I could see it as coming in handy, and then you already have somebody that the board has pre-designated in situations of need to speak on the board's behalf. For the most part, most things can be handled at a staff level.
I wish that Eric was here, because I would almost want to volunteer him for that.
Well, that's generally the rule.
Yeah.
He's not here. He's not
it's here. It's an appointment.
That's right.
Can you please appoint Eric to LAFCO?
I'm sure Herb would love LAFCO. And if he declines, I'll take it. But that's not good. Point of take.
I don't know that he gets to decline a presidential appointment.
Oh, wow.
Oh.
Ooh. Yeah, it's your first bit of real power you got here.
Oh, boy. So we have her for LAFCO. Anybody want to volunteer for a fire commission?
Well, you were on it last year.
Yeah, do you have any preferences?
I have a preference to do none. I'm taking a class on Sunday nights and Monday nights starting in a week, and so I'm feeling very possessive of my
You have a class?
I don't mind
the fire commission. It's yeah, I can do that.
You guys want to switch off?
Actually, I think I'd like to continue one more year with the Park and Rec, if you don't mind. I'd like to see if I can pay a little bit more attention to the shed issue in the next coming year.
Yeah, I'd love to get that going. So, okay, well, Isabella, you get the fire commission. Okay.
We have to vote on that
Friday.
No, he just appointed.
And Jeff, you get Park and Rec?
Yeah. Much to their dismay.
Okay. And the update on the future editions of the e-newsletter.
Yeah, may I make a comment on this? First of all, thanks for serving as usual. But I do want to say something about LAFCO. LAFCO, you got to pay attention to. LAFCO can change our whole community. It can change our fire district. It is a very powerful agency. You need experienced, mature eyes on LAFCO. And I think you got the two best. Scott, well, Irv would be fantastic.
Yeah.
So I guess I want to say, don't leave it to staff. Make sure you know what's going on with on the LAFCO.
Very good, thank you. Yeah, I asked to have this put on the agenda, and one of the findings I've had about serving on this board over the last year is that I've virtually changed my mind on about everything I thought I was going to be doing when I first started serving on this board. I brought up the concept of a quarterly e-newsletter sometime during my tenure, and I started to have some, based on working with staff, based on working with the district manager, and realizing the workload that they are under all the time, I want to pose a question as opposed to a quarterly newsletter. We already have a quarterly report that goes out. And this is something Stephen mentioned, I think, previously. If there are messages or announcements that we'd like to make, and we don't want to wait for the quarterly newsletter to go out, couldn't we put something out in sort of a blog fashion, you know, and not have to, you know, go through the extra work of having to, you know, create a quarterly e-newsletter, but just put something out there so it gets information out to the public on an as-needed basis? Would that be simpler?
It would be beautiful to have it on my website. I can't speak from the staff's perspective, well, but that's what the website is supposed to be for.
Yeah, exactly.
It should be a vehicle of communication, and I think more people now just go to Marinwood.org whenever they please, rather than wait for...
Right.
So,
you know, I think honestly, you know, I don't know if the scrolling message is the right place to announce these things, but, you know, certainly having something where if there's something of public interest...
There is a section.
Yeah. We just put stuff out there. And it doesn't take as much energy as, you know, it takes to create a quarterly newsletter.
Well, I think that these guys are pretty good about utilizing some of the forms of social media to our advantage, primarily, you know, Facebook, pushing that out, because I do agree that you can't just wait for them to come to you on certain things. You need to push it to them. And on certain things, depending what the announcement is, we obviously have some levels of email lists you can utilize without creating a multifaceted newsletter, even if it be through Adobe Slate, or you do something like Constant Contact that is incredibly efficiently priced to get something out as a blast, depending on priority or how much it's it can be done.
Yeah, my interest is in communication and fostering communication, and also it's free marketing for some of the wonderful work that you folks do around here, you know, that we can get out to the public. And you know, if we can do that without a tremendous amount of extra effort, I'll completely back off a quarterly newsletter and let's just put stuff out as we can. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Does that take weight off your shoulder?
Sure. And I think, you know, Shane and I spent a little bit of time talking about this the other week, a couple weeks ago, I think, too. And, you know, it's tough to always stay on top of everything when everything is constantly in a state of flux, it seems. I can certainly relate to your comment of your thoughts on what you would be doing have changed in the course of a year. I can empathize, but it is, I still think it's a good thing to get out there, and I think even if you kind of put something out in correlation with when the reviews are coming out, it's still good too, that don't necessarily make the review, because I don't know that the review is the right place for some of these kind of stories or whatever that we're putting together. I think people look to the review primarily for, great, what times are classes, how much are they, like everything that. Else.
Sure.
And I still think that there's some level of an avenue for it, but it just, I'm waiting for the light at the end of the tunnel when we have something consistent.
Understood. Yeah, I'm just hoping that this idea is one that doesn't exhaust, you know, you know, your folks' efforts in, you know, creating another polished vehicle. Instead, news bites or something like that, as opposed to a...
Key of a successful communication is the timeliness,
right? Exactly.
And so it's better to have it timely than in a perfect way.
If that helps, I think that.
Yeah, and I do, like I said, I think they've been good, depending on what the message is, either utilizing Facebook. I know the chief utilizes Nextdoor quite a bit for kind of emergency or safety updates. You know, we even sent something out today that after we all kind of took a walk down and means something to me, coming from people who've been here much longer than I have. They've never seen the creek quite so high or moving so quickly. Don't forget, stay away from the creek and keep your kids away from it, kind of a
sure.
But also the urgent notice website that you utilize for the sandbags, right? Or those?
We utilize it for something.
Anything else? Yeah, a couple things. First of all, Good ideas, Jeff. Let me assure you that it's not that difficult to take a bunch of blog posts and create an HTML letter and say, you know, just a little teaser, read more here, brings you to our website. It's, that's really quite easy. The other thing I would say is, I know you have people doing marketing, right, creating stuff, but I suggest one of your staff members, maybe it's Robin, maybe it's Luke, I don't know, but it should be somebody who's really kind of the marketing director, if you will, in charge of communication. I think if you do that, then it won't be, you know, an afterthought. There would actually be, and you know, give them a task, okay, with every quarter that we send out the review, this is kind of what we want. And so he or she would be pulling from the staff members, well, what do you have on this or that? And they would be in charge of that, that community outreach. We have to do it because it's a lot cheaper. We could save a lot of money in printing and mail costs if we can do more stuff electronically, and it's better quality. If you want a great example of marketing outreach, you can go to Osher Marin JCC. They do a fantastic job of marketing. They have TVs in the reception area. They're constantly putting stuff out. They really do a good job, and maybe we don't have the resources to imitate that, but it's a good model to follow. And so, there you go.
Thank you. Anything else? Request for a future meeting agenda items. Isabel?
May we get the shed on the agenda?
No problem.
Because we really need to plow forward with this. And maybe just having it on the agenda will bring more energy to put more energy towards this project here at Opal.
Yeah.
Another thing is something that came up is the financial reserves policy. I take it upon myself to put the draft out.
Okay.
And that's for next item.
So that the financial reserves policy was not in the manual that we just finished.
The handbook that's in the ether of
that's right. I forgot.
That's an employee handbook.
That's employee handbook, yeah, so that's different from the policy.
Yeah, okay. Just out of curiosity, when's the last time you opened up the Dead Sea Scrolls?
Last time I went to the Dead Sea.
You know what I'm talking about.
I do. Are you referring
to
if we have some level of a financial reserve policy in place now?
Yes.
Considering we have no financial reserves.
Memory stick with policies and ordinances that I have to look through, and hopefully we can. It is in a format that we can put it up on the website without embarrassing the district. So we'll be working towards.
Yeah. I would say any policy that may be in there would certainly need to be reviewed.
Sure.
Prior to establishing.
This is for discussion, policy. Correct?
Right.
Yeah. And eventually
approved. Eventual option.
Yeah, that was actually in my. My write-up today, but I forgot to mention it. At any rate, I have a draft, and I would be happy to send it to you.
Oh,
you
yeah.
Play with it and change it and polish it up. Great.
I got it. I need it.
Anything else? From the public?
Oh, yeah, just one thing. This has been a great year. You've done a lot of good things, and despite the differences, I think you've really come a long way. You're making progress, and I encourage you to have a great 2017. And I also want to invite all of you to, I can't, if you want to show up to the Marine Coalition tomorrow, they might let you in, but there's a talk on government transparency that you might find interesting. That's at McGinnis.
Okay, on to recognitions and board member items of interest. Isabella.
I would like to recognize all our staff, the fire department, but also the park department and recreation department for really pulling through this wet period that we've been...
The atmospheric river.
The atmospheric river, indeed. And, you know, clearing trees and showing up where they're needed and preemptively looking into potential problem zones. It's
well done.
Yeah, these are moments where we're all proud of you guys, and thank you for doing what you're doing.
I want to recognize Jeff Naylor for the work that he did on the ad hoc committee.
Thank you.
He did a great job putting everything down.
Thank you.
Unfortunately, I participated only for several hours. That was not nearly the amount of time that he did. So I really appreciate it.
Certainly second my bills.
Thank you.
Not that he participated for only a couple hours part, but all the great stuff he did.
Of course. Anybody else? I would like to hear a motion to adjourn.
Second.
All those in favor?
Do you want to have any discussion first?
Aye.